Ladies and gentlemen, yes, it works. A warm welcome to you all. My name is Aletta Hecker and I'm the Deputy Mayor of Delft. As a director and a politician, I'm deeply committed to the freedom to express yourself. Free thoughts create free people. And that freedom is our greatest wealth. However, this freedom has not always been self-evident, and for many it still isn't. Individual freedom deserves all of our protection. This evening is the third time the Van Hasselt lecture is held. These lectures are all focused around the themes of ethics, technique, peace, and justice. The lecture itself is named after the Delft student Frans van Hasselt. On the 23rd of November of 1940, he held a lecture aimed against the imposed suspension of Jewish professors. Did he use inflammatory language? Did he call upon the students to take up arms? No. In fact, he did none of this. Despite being the paragon of prudency, he felt entitled to speak out, modest yet immovable. The power of his words reached far and wide. The students went on strike, and the occupier was at loss what to do. Yes, they arrested Van Hasselt several days after the strike, and he was put on transport to Buchenwald, where he passed away 2 years later on the 10th of November. In Delft, we continue to remember Frans van Hasselt. Remembrance keeps our past life, alive. We find meaning in today's events by seeing the parallels with the past, executing change powered by lessons learned from those who went before us. During the Second World War, the students and the professors of Delft faced enormous dilemmas. Students were asked to sign an oath of allegiance to show their loyalty to the Nazi regime. If they refused, they would be put on transport to Germany. This had an immense impact on the relationship between the students and the professors. Looking back, we might be tempted to judge the choices they have made in terms of good and evil. But today, too, we must face choices created by events happening worldwide. What ensures that we make the right choices in the eyes of our children and of our grandchildren? History teaches us that in the end. And in the end, words are bound to win over arms. A fact undoubtedly known to Van Hasselt as well, including the risk he was running and which he was prepared to resign to, witnesses one of the passages in his address to his fellow students, which goes, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for the sake of justice, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." I would like to wish you an inspiring night on the path to a safe and free world. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone. For those of you who do not know me, I'm Tim van der Hagen, president of the Delft University of Technology, or TU Delft, as we usually say. Thank you very much, Aletta. Well, she already left us for talking to us about the importance of remembering our past, and preferably learning from it, and in particular about Van Hasselt's past, who we are remembering here tonight. Now, if you take the time to look around you in Delft, you will find that Van Hasselt is being commemorated at several locations. We have a Van Hasselt Lane and a Van Hasselt Square that were named after him in respectively 1974 and 1994. And in 2014, we unveiled a memorial plaque in honor of Frans van Hasselt at the Oostplantsoen, where back in 1940, the civil engineering building stood, where he held his famous speech. On our own campus, we have, among others, a bronze plaque in the hall of the aula, with the 180 names of those who died at the hands of the Nazis, van Hasselt among them. It is here that every year, on Remembrance Day, we lay a wreath to honor those who lost their lives. And it pleases me to see that students today still take an interest in such ceremonies. And then, close to the Frans van Hasselt's room in our aula building, hangs a painting of Frans van Hasselt. This was made by his aunt in the 1930s and given to the TU Delft in 2004. We hope that when people pass these places, now and then spare a thought for Frans van Hasselt. Because, as Aletta Hecker just pointed out, he and his fellow students and their professors faced a moral choice. Should they comply with the new rules and hope for things to get better? Or should they speak out or even rise up against what they felt to be morally wrong? By staying silent, they did nothing to help those suffering at the hands of the Nazis. But by speaking or by acting out, they would endanger themselves and those close to them. What would you have done? Or I? I simply don't know. Fortunately, we live in a time and place of peace and prosperity. We do not face such life or death dilemmas. But still, we are faced with moral choices throughout our lives, as engineers and scientists, as managers and as human beings. And that is why we have established this annual van Hasselt lecture. Not just to commemorate van Hasselt's brave act and his tragic death, but also to remind ourselves of our moral choices and responsibility, and to prepare our students that they will be facing such choices too in their professional career. And in that last case, I'm talking in particular about those choices that are involved with new technology. Don't get me wrong. As the president of a university of technology, I'm all in favor of new technology. We can do marvelous things with it, but we can also cause untold harm with it. And sometimes the difference is very clear. Nobody would mistake an autonomous weapon for a nursing robot. Yet they are based on the same technology, robotics. So are we also to blame for the one if we work on developing the other? But the line can be much finer than that. What if you decide to have another child because your firstborn has leukemia and a sibling's stem cells can save it? That in itself is a contentious issue, but it happens. So why not make sure that stem cells are a match in the first place? And that brings me to the subject of today's lecture, gene editing. Because gene editing is another wonderful yet controversial subject. In recent years, a new technique was developed that can be used to modify genes with enormous precision. It is called CRISPR-Cas. Let's leave the acronym and how it works exactly for another time. Let's see what it can do. With CRISPR-Cas, we can edit genetic material in living organisms. For example, you could use it to modify mosquitoes and in that way eliminate malaria. Or we can use it for crop improvement that is much more precise than the traditional methods. For example, by modifying the infamous gluten in wheat into something that people are not allergic to. And only last week, a team of our students won the International Genetically Engineered Machine, or INGEM, competition in Boston. And their winning idea was a quick method to find out if dairy cattle carry bacteria that are resistant to antibiotics. They developed these tests with the help of CRISPR-Cas. It can help farmers to reduce the unnecessary use of antibiotics. And of course, we are very proud of them. So what about human DNA? This summer, scientists in the US used the CRISPR gene editing tool to modify the DNA of human embryos for the first time, although it had been done before in China. They did so to edit out a gene that causes a heart condition that can lead to sudden death. It was purely for research purposes. No babies were born from those embryos, but they showed it could be done. And that is the first step towards preventing babies being born with incurable diseases. Sounds good, doesn't it? Or maybe it doesn't. Because where do you draw the line? That is a slippery slope. Where one day you may still be doing good, and the next day you're actually making designer babies, selecting embryos on the color of their skin, or their height, or other specifics. And that comes frighteningly close to what was being done by Josef Mengele, who experimented on prisoners in Auschwitz in the dark days of the Second World War, we are remembering here today. This Nazi angel of death was fascinated by genes. One of the things he wanted to find out was by what genetic twist twins were born, so he could increase the birth rate of the, in the eyes of the Nazis, superior Aryan race. Surely we don't want that history to repeat itself. So what about using CRISPR to cure people already born? Can there be any objection to that? And here too, progress is being made. Only last week, again, American scientists edited a gene inside the body of a man suffering from the incurable Hunter syndrome, a metabolic disease. The brave patient knows there's no guarantee of success and may even be dangerous, but he's willing to take the risk in the hope that if it may not help him, it will help others in the long term. But what about Josiah Zehner, a man who calls himself a biohacker? He used CRISPR to remove a protein that inhibits muscle growth from his forearm. His goal was not to get bigger arm muscles, but to prove to the world that humans are no longer slave to the genes they were born with. He believes science should be democratized and everybody should have access to the tools for gene editing. Is he a hero in a long line of scientists who had the courage to perform dangerous experiments upon themselves to further science? I'm not too sure. If you ask me, the last thing we should want is to let every Tom, Dick or Harry loose with his or her own gene editing kit. Nevertheless, fascinating stuff. And I could come up with another 20 thought-provoking questions. But how about the answers? And that is why we have invited tonight's speaker, Professor Annelien Bredenoort of the University Medical Center in Utrecht, who will be talking to us about the complex relationship between gene editing technology, our societies, institutes, and ethics. Now, I doubt that she will have all the answers, because nobody has those yet. But I'm sure she can enlighten us a whole lot further on the subject. So before I will ask her to come up here, let me tell you something more about her. Annelien Bredenoort is professor of the ethics of biomedical innovation. She studied theology and political sciences at Leiden University, and she obtained a PhD at the medical faculty of Maastricht University. And she has been working at the University Medical Center Utrecht ever since. She teaches ethics at the Faculty of Medicine at Utrecht University, and she advises on medical and ethical policy in national and international committees. She is also a member of the Young Academy of the Royal Dutch Academy of Sciences, or the KNAW, K-N-A-W, as we say in Dutch. In her research, she focuses on the ethical and societal issues surrounding new and often controversial technology, such as stem cell research, genetics, regenerative medicine, and big data. But before we are going to listen to Annelien, we will all enjoy a musical interlude by a quartet with the name Quadrivium, composed of Lester Laardenooi, Guido Groenland, Jan Douwes, and Bram Trouwborst. Please, ladies and gentlemen, Quadrivium.
Oh,
Thank you very much, Quadrivium. It's really a great honor to be invited to give the Van Hasselt lecture. Yes. Thank you. Is it better like this?
Okay.
Great. As we heard from the president, Frans Van Hasselt gave a speech on the 23rd of November, 1940, denouncing the dismissal of Jewish professors at the university. Van Hasselt was arrested by the German occupying forces and died in 1942 at Buchenwald concentration camp. Actually, Buchenwald was the first concentration camp I ever visited in my life. In 1995, I was selected for a European Union exchange program with Germany. I was 16 and I stayed with a German family in Weimar for 6 weeks. And this exchange made a deep impression. Weimar and its surroundings were so full of contradictions. There was the deep intellectual and cultural life of Weimar, with the Bauhaus architects, Goethe, who lived there, the Nietzsche archive nearby. There was Wittenberg, the castle where Luther pinned his 95 theses and ignited the Reformation exactly 500 years ago. But at the same time, next to all this culture, we experienced the impoverished families after decades of communism in the former East German city. And the head of the school we attended told us in tears how she was separated from her family for many years due to the war. And just outside Weimar, there was Buchenwald. And I'm deeply aware that a visit to this place gives only a glimpse of the atrocities.
But at least I have a minor impression of the place where Frans van Hasselt died 75 years ago. And I'm also mindful that the topic that I will be talking about today, which are the developments in genome editing technologies, is quite controversial. One particular concern that is posed regularly is a comparison between gene editing techniques and the eugenics movement, particularly the German eugenics program. And there are many differences, fortunately. But this comparison reminds us, in a cruel sense, of the ethical and societal impact of scientific ideas. And it urges us to consider the bigger picture of new technologies. So we need to comprehensively address the impact on our societies, our institutions, and on ethics. And that is also my aim of this lecture, to discuss the complex relationship between the emerging gene editing technology, society, institutions, and ethics. And I will try to take you through a historical tour through some important milestones of technological advancement in genetic and reproductive medicine and the associated ethical debate that have affected individuals and society for over the last 60 years. And my key point will be that genome editing has such an impact on such a broad array of human life that ethics and governance should be an intrinsic part of responsible innovation in this field. Gene editing, not sure whether you can see the slides, but gene editing or genome editing is a set of methods to create changes in DNA sequences of virtually every organism. The idea of genetic engineering is not new. It has been used for over 35 years, and also the ethical discussion started already in the 1970s. But the technique were quite inefficient and they often lacked specificity. And this changed in 2012 with the development of a new gene editing method, CRISPR-Cas9. CRISPR-Cas has been hailed by its unparalleled potential for modifying human and non-human genomes. It really is considered a game changer. CRISPR-Cas makes it possible to make precise additions, deletions, and alterations to the genome, or even an organism's complete set of genetic material. It has significant, as we heard, significant potential in a very wide range of sectors, in human and animal health, food, agriculture, the modification of populations in the wild, and much more. CRISPR has been rapidly adopted by laboratories and scientists worldwide. For example, for altering cells in the lab to study the function of particular genes, for developing animal models for studying human diseases, for creating modified crops and plants, and to improve food production, and to tackle issues of food and nutrition security. And I will not go in depth into the technique and the mechanism behind genome editing, first because I'm an ethicist, so that's not my expertise, but second also because it's not necessary for the purpose of my main message about the ethical and societal implications of gene editing. But for sake of clarity and simplicity, I usually compare CRISPR-Cas with molecular scissors that can make very precise cuts and pastes in the DNA of virtually every organism. And particularly in the field of biomedicine, there are three applications of genome editing foreseen. The first application is using genome editing technique for basic scientific research purposes, some of which I already described, such as research to address fundamental questions of human and non-human animal biology. The second application is research to generate data for the development of human somatic applications, which means using CRISPR-Cas for types of gene therapy. As many as about 20 clinical trials are now internationally underway, targeting conditions including different kinds of cancers, Duchenne, muscular dystrophy, and some rare diseases. A third application involves gene editing in the context of reproduction. So this is called clinical reproductive embryo editing. And this means that the DNA of oocytes or eggs, sperm, or the early human embryo is modified and transplanted in the womb, which then should result in a pregnancy and a baby. So this is really for reproductive purposes, making babies, making healthy babies. And this would also encompass what we call germline modification, which is a genetic modification that can be passed over to your children and the following generation and the following generation. And it is particularly this third application that has raised this fierce international ethical debate, not only between scientists themselves, but also broader in society. And in what follows, I will focus specifically on this application because it really forms the nexus of the socio-ethical debates, and because I think it illustrates the deeper and broader impact of science and technology. First, a very small backdrop of history. Historians, they tend to talk in terms of fault lines and continuity. I think the emergence of CRISPR-Cas is both a game changer, so a fault line, but it's also a very logical step in the development that started decades ago. There were two important developments. The first relevant development is the emergence of recombinant DNA technology in the 1970s, which is now very widely used in all fields of biotechnology. But this is the first type of genetic engineering. And the second relevant development is the invention and the first uses of in vitro fertilization, IVF. During the 1970s, gynecologist Patrick Steptoe and biologist Robert Edwards, they pioneered a procedure that later became known as in vitro fertilization. And this resulted in 1978 in the birth of Louisa Brown. You can see her over here about 35 years later. And this birth was really announced as the world's first test tube baby, which actually is a misnomer because her conception occurred in a Petri dish. But Louisa Brown was welcomed in the world as she were a princess. So it's a girl, super babe. You can see it in all newspapers all over the world. And the newspapers, they also showed headlines expressing both hopes, but also fears. And I think that the moral arguments and emotions that can now be identified, newspapers then, they showed moral arguments and emotions that can now be identified as a set of repeating moral patterns of argumentation that is applicable to any new biotechnology. I will come back to this issue a bit later. IVF was initially introduced as a form of treatment for couples facing infertility. IVF also laid the groundwork for further innovations in reproductive medicine and genetic technology. During the years, IVF has increasingly been deployed as a vehicle for using genetic technology. And an outstanding present-day example of this alliance between IVF and genetics is pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, screening embryos, in also called PGD. And in PGD, embryos are created in vitro, so outside the human body, in the Petri dish, and they are analyzed for a particular genetic mutation or defect. And after this genetic analysis, one or two unaffected embryos are transferred to the womb, and this should result in a pregnancy. And all these so-called reproductive genetic technologies go hand in hand with ethical challenges. And although there is an ongoing international debate, also internationally, about these technologies, they now are broadly accepted in many, if not most, Western countries. But there's one application is often considered the line in the sand that we should not cross. And this is germline modification. As I said before, germline modification can be defined as any biomedical intervention that modifies the genome that a person can transmit to his child and the further generations. And not all genetic modifications affect this germline, but genetic modifications in particular cells, the still pluripotent cells of the early embryo, as you can see over here, they can involve germline modification. And that germline modification is by many perceived as a line in the sand, is for example expressed by many legal prohibitions. So if you, for example, take a look at the Council of Europe Oviedo Convention, which is a very influential document for regulating scientific research, if you see Article 13, it reads the following. An intervention seeking to modify the human genome may only be undertaken for preventive, diagnostic, or therapeutic purposes, and only if its aim is not to introduce any modification in the genome of any descendant. End quote. Similarly, our Dutch embryo law, people that often don't know we have an embryo law, but this law states in Article 24, it is prohibited to intentionally modify the genetic material of the nucleus of human germ cells used to create a pregnancy. So this prohibits germline modification as well. Well, for a long time, germline modification was really only a theoretical option. Until recently, the technological tools that enable a viable path to realizing human germline modification, they were not available. So this means actually that a very restrictive policy would not come at any price, and it was relatively uncontested. But CRISPR-Cas has radically changed this because the technology is here now. But it's good to realize that there's another development that people tend to overlook in the discussion, which is also a kind of germline modification, and which is actually already applied in other countries in the world. And this is mitochondrial replacement technology, or also called mitochondrial gene transfer or mitochondrial donation. Let me tell me a little bit out, about mitochondria and the mitochondrial donation, because it's very relevant for the international discussion. As you may know or may not know, mitochondria are tiny organelles in the cytoplasm surrounding the nucleus, and they serve as the powerhouses of our cells. Mitochondrial DNA disorders often result in very severe diseases involving defects in cellular energy production. And because there is no effective treatment helping carriers of mitochondrial DNA mutation to have healthy, genetically related children, this has been a key focus. A solution could be a new reproductive genetic technology that is called mitochondrial replacement technology. And this transfers the nuclear DNA of a woman's egg, or zygote, which is the fertilized egg, carrying a mitochondrial mutation into a donor egg with healthy mitochondria. And mitochondria, they have their own DNA, and the mitochondrial genome differs from the genetic material in our nuclear DNA in several aspects. The mitochondrial genome, for example, is very small. It only contains 37 genes. They have a very specific function. They are all involved in the cell's energy production, whereas the nuclear DNA has a much wider range, and it also has its own transmission pattern. But these differences do not change the fact that modification of the mitochondrial genome in early embryonic cells can be transmitted to further generation. And as this is the core of the concept of germline modification, that it can be transmitted to further generation, the concept can also be applied to any modification in the mitochondrial genome. So a couple of years ago, research has already shown the feasibility of mitochondrial DNA replacement in human oocytes and in embryos. And this research has particularly been developed in the United Kingdom, in Newcastle. So in February 2015, after a very extensive societal debate, co-organized by the Human Fertilization and Embryology Authority, the HFEA, the UK Parliament voted in favor of changing the law and permitting mitochondrial replacement technology. And in my perspective, the process in the UK leading to the parliamentary debates about mitochondrial replacement technique was the poster child of responsible innovation. Let me tell you some of the ingredients in this process. There have been preclinical studies in the laboratory for over a decade, which was funded by several British funding agencies. So there was enough collective money. There is an institution, this HFEA, that has very strict oversight and that will regulate mitochondrial replacement technique by means of a licensing system. In addition, the UK only moved mitochondrial replacement further after extensive ethical, societal and political debate. The HFEA, but also many politicians, patient organizations and the researchers and clinicians in Newcastle, they played a role in facilitating a very widespread and deep social discourse over this new reproductive technique. So the UK has the regulatory, the funding and the deliberative framework in place to develop and support mitochondrial replacements. Similarly, in the United States, the Institute of Medicine, which is part of the National Academy of Sciences, they played a similar role, although there are, of course, many political and social attitudes differences between the UK and the US towards new biotechnology. But I think the examples in both the UK and the US, they show that expert debate combined with political and public involvement is possible and that governance can be achieved in principle. So I was therefore not amused, to say the least, when clinicians presented the world's first baby born through mitochondrial replacement technique in Mexico and Ukraine in 2016. And this, you can see it over here, this Mexican world first was accomplished by clinicians taking a regulatory detour by carrying out the mitochondrial replacement technique in their private New York clinic and then shipping the embryo to their Mexican clinic for transfer to the patient in order to avoid a complex range of US regulatory issues. And at the same time, in Ukraine, the same technique has been used not for making a baby without serious mitochondrial DNA disease, but to rejuvenate the fertility of aging oocytes. In other words, a very experimental technique has been used to improve the chances of IVF. Although this application is without any scientific evidence, and it's not proven safe or effective. So I think it's clear, and also earlier this year, we wrote a commentary international that both applications in Mexico and Ukraine are premature and also morally problematic. The teams of clinicians in Mexico and Ukraine, they proceeded to create the world's first genetically modified babies in the absence of specific governance for the use of these technologies. Fortunately, both procedures resulted in thus far healthy babies, but seeking areas of low governance is not the way forward for biotechnology that has such broad ethical and societal impact. So let me now jump to germline genome editing, which will have an even broader impact. You can see over here, don't edit the human germline, a prudent path forward for germline genome editing. These were the titles of commentaries and opinions that appeared in March 2015 in the leading scientific journals, including Nature and Science. Some scientists who usually screen the table of contents of these journals might have been thinking, what is happening here that this old debate is refreshed again? But apparently the writers of these commentaries, they had some foreknowledge. Because indeed, in April 2015, an article from a Chinese group from Sun Yat-sen University in Guangzhou, they published in a rather unknown journal, Protein and Cell. And in this publication, which you can see over here, the group showed proof of principle of editing human embryos in the lab by means of CRISPR-Cas. And the group used non-viable embryos, which means they cannot develop into a child, that were obtained from local fertility clinics. And they tried to modify the gene responsible for beta thalassemia, which is a potentially fatal blood disorder. And the results were very inefficient, and they showed many off-target effects, which means that the CRISPR system hits other genes than the intended ones, but the potential was shown. So the first step was there. And this first publication ignited a very fierce international debate about the ethics of germline modification. But it also raised questions of publication ethics. The lead author of this Chinese study said that the paper was rejected by both Nature and Science, in part because of ethical objections by the editors. Both journals declined to comment on the claim, but I heard this as well on several scientific meetings. So let us assume that indeed this was the reason for rejecting the paper. Did the editorial teams make the right decision? And what ethics were they referring to? The experiments were not unlawful in China, and also not in many other countries in the world. Transferring an edited embryo in a womb is unlawful almost everywhere, but making the modifications in the lab is not. It would not be in the Netherlands either. The researchers in China have obtained permission from their local ethics review boards, which is required for such studies. The researchers also used non-viable human embryos that had three rather than two pairs of chromosomes, which means they would never have been able to develop into a child. And they had permission from the providers of the egg cell and the sperm cell, and they discarded the embryos before 14 days, so abiding to the so-called 14-day rule. So actually, the research was solidly within international accepted standards for research, even though this kind of research is controversial. So one could ask the question whether it's up to the editorial team to decide a publication is unethical, also when the country of origin doesn't view it this way. Many other countries don't see it this way, and local ethics permission has been obtained. And Nature since then accepted other publications with germline genome editing experiments. So they might have changed their position, but it might be the case that they came from the US, Sweden, and the UK. So some commentators, I think, rightly argued that we should not spread the narrative that China is some kind of wild west of genetic research. Another option for them would have been to publish the paper and to invite different ethicists, researchers, and also patients to comment on the experiment and to give in this way an impetus to the first international ethics discussion. So here you can see Jennifer Doudna, and she is one of the inventors of CRISPR-Cas9. And actually she expressed quite some concerns in interviews, so in this interview in a Dutch newspaper, the Volkskrant, but also in her book, A Crack in Creation, which is worthwhile reading. And actually she expressed concerns about the technology she co-created herself. And she called for a moratorium on certain uses, while others have argued that the continuation of genome editing research is a moral imperative. So you can see that scientists are really divided themselves. And I think it's germline gene editing really divided the scientific community. So after this first publication, several governance mechanisms came in action. We, for example, gathered with a group of ethicists, scientists, and clinicians working in the field of stem cell ethics, known as the Hingston Group. We came together in the UK to draft a consensus statement on the ethics of genome editing. And in the Netherlands, the Health Council of the Netherlands also organized a two-day symposium. But it all came together at the International Summit on Human Gene Editing, a three-day meeting in Washington, D.C. And this was organized by the American Academy of Sciences, the UK Royal Society, and the Chinese Academy of Sciences. And all academies of sciences were invited to send one or two representatives together with some patients and policymakers. I don't know whether you can see it from there, but I was invited to chair the session of the ethical and societal implications of germline genome editing. And I think it was an historical event, and for me at least, it was an historical experience, because the panel included a very broad array of persons and voices. For example, it included one of the world's most liberal bioethicists. You can see off there, John Harris, for the philosophers in the room. It included a Catholic theologian, the president of a conservative technology think tank, and two mothers of children who suffered genetic disease or died from genetic disease. So you can imagine it was a very rich and also emotional discussion in Washington, D.C. And we discussed a very broad array of ethical and societal aspects. And it's not my aim here to discuss and examine all relevant arguments, also because this would be undoable in just one evening, because there are many, many, many aspects. To give an example, last year we conducted a systematic review of reasons in the literature, in which the most important biomedical electronic databases were systematically searched for articles covering reasons for or against germline modification. And the reported reasons were extracted from the articles, and they were grouped into categories by content analysis. And we also conducted an online questionnaire on the website De Kennis van Nu, which is a popular Dutch science media outlet, in which we asked Dutch citizens about their attitudes and views towards genome editing in general, and germline editing in particular. And we conducted this study because I'm convinced that exploring what we call lay morality is of key importance in this field. And we found about 169 different arguments and reasons. So this is why I'm not going to discuss these with you. But to make it a bit more tangible and clear, we categorized the reasons from the literature review, so the reasons expressed by experts, into 13 domains. And broadly, they wrote about quality of life of patients, about safety of the technique, about effectiveness, about the existence of a clinical need or an alternative way of having healthy babies, about the cost, about Homo sapiens, so the effect on humans as a species, about social justice, the potential for misuse, special interests such as the commercialization of this technique and also the pressure on scientists, about parental rights and duties, the comparability to earlier techniques such as pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, the rights of the unborn child, and human life and dignity. And they also wrote about the implementation and regulation. And the reasons from the online questionnaire, so of the interested Dutch lay people, actually could be categorized in more or less the same domains. They didn't mention some topics, for example, the commercialization was not mentioned by citizens. The pressure on scientists were not mentioned. And they neither mentioned the rights of the unborn child. But they added two points of discussion, reproductive autonomy and the argument of nature. I think it's good to realize that these sets of arguments, most arguments actually, they were often deployed both in favor of germline modification, but also as an argument against germline modification. So for example, the principle of human dignity is expressed as a reason in favor of editing diseased embryos, but it's also used as a reason for not doing this. So that's quite difficult sometimes. So as I said, I won't give you a complete list of all the possible and valid arguments, but I think what is important from the Washington DC Gene Editing Summit and from what we found in the literature are two points. The first point is that actually we did not hear completely new arguments. So it's a new technique, but we didn't learn any new arguments. But in the fears and expectations and hopes, the different basic attitudes towards technology became clear. And the second point was that this was the first time a broad community discussed the ethical societal impact of genome editing technique in general, and reproductive technologies also more general. So in the debate surrounding germline modification, as I just told you, broadly three basic positions towards technology can be discerned. And of course, these basic attitudes are well known from earlier debates, for example, on enhancement technology. And of course, it's always more nuanced than just the three categories, but for sake of clarity, I will delineate these three positions. The first basic position endorses a more pessimist, negative attitudes towards biotechnology. And this was also expressed in our panel. The group is often called bioconservatives, and they are very skeptical towards new biotechnology. It considers technology as an autonomous force that is largely uncontrollable, so out of human control. Often metaphors of a hurtling train are used. And the portrayal of man is one of a created being without with limitations. So a created being with limitations. human beings have their own essence or nature, one should not tinker with. The moral attitudes toward mankind is one of gratitude for life as a gift. And one well-known representative is Michael Sandel, who argues in his 2004 book, The Case Against Perfection, against what he calls our quest for mastery, which would threaten our appreciation as life as a gift. It's this second book. The opposite position endorses a techno-optimistic stance towards new biotechnology. This group is often called transhumanists, and they consider technology as a largely controllable and desirable process for the human condition. The portrayal of man is one in which humans are free, rational, and creative beings. The moral attitude towards mankind is one of creativity and control. And they seek to apply reason, science, and technology for the purposes of societal aims, such as reducing disease and disability. Many transhumanists support the thesis that human beings may eventually be able to transform themselves into different beings with abilities so greatly expanded from our natural condition as to merit the label of post-human beings. And then there's a third basic attitude towards biotechnology that depicts technology merely as neutral or value-free, meaning technology would not be good or bad in itself, but that what counts is not the technology, but the way we use it. And all we need, according to this position, is proper risk assessments before introducing new biotechnology. So just to see whether you are still with me here, after hearing these three positions, who considers him or herself as in the domain of the bioconservatives? Please raise your hand. With many nuances. So I think that's about 10 hands. And who considers him or herself a transhumanist? I think it's the same, actually. And who sees technology as neutral? Depends on what we are doing. Oh, wow. That's the biggest group. Ah, okay. Well, to be honest, I'm a bit surprised. I have to recover a second from... I expected here in Delft many transhumanists. Yeah. Many have a positive stance towards technology. And a vision as man, as a rational, creative being. Yeah. I didn't accept the neutral position. So, to disclose, I have difficulties with all three positions towards technology. I think the bioconservative view, I'm not going to insult anyone, but I think it's way too deterministic. And it's not clear at all why we should appreciate life as a gift and not strive for improvement when it's full of suffering and imperfections. The transhumanist view leans too much on humans as essentially rational beings that can use blueprints. There is too much makeable or manufacturability, I think, in this position. And I think the neutral view on technology, I think it can be quite simply be rejected on empirical grounds. To use a quote from Dutch philosopher Peter Paul Verbeek, he says, I quote, "A chair determines how we sit. Microbes forces us to cook our milk. A seatbelt relieves us of the responsibility to drive gently. A speed bump forces us to brake for a crossover." End quote. So, in other words, things can influence as well. Things can be actors as well. Or in the words of another sociologist, Sheila Jasanoff, our inventions change the world and the reinvented world changes us. Technology cannot be neutral. So I think with these quotes, I arrive at a fourth position in which I want to avoid the, in my opinion, very non-predictive, very polarized debates. Are you for or against germline modification? Is it yes or is it no? Is it good or is it designer babies? Sociologists such as Bruno Latour, Sheila Jasanoff, many others have shown how science, technology, ethics, and society how they are deeply interactive and interwoven with each other. And they explain in their work how science and society so-called co-produce each other. And this social constructivist view sees the development of technology as an inherent part of human activities. What we need to do is trying to figure out effective, inclusive, and realistic institutional responses to the challenges of new technology, including germline genome editing. And then I come back at the Washington DC Gene Editing Summit, because particularly the way we as societies have to deal with these technologies came in the end to the fore in DC. So the discussion and also the consensus statement expressed a deeply felt need for broader deliberation and a public forum. So here you can see a snapshot from the consensus statement from this meeting. And it, for example, says, it would be irresponsible to proceed with any clinical use of germline editing unless and until the relevant safety and efficacy issues have been resolved, based on appropriate understanding of balancing of risk, potential benefit, and alternatives. And two, there is a broad societal consensus about the appropriateness of the proposed application. And at the end of the statement, it says, the international community should strive to establish norms concerning acceptable uses of human germline editing and to harmonize regulation in order to discourage unacceptable activities while advancing human health and welfare. And this needed forum, it should be inclusive among nations and engage a wide range of perspectives and expertise, including, and then there is a long list, biomedical scientists, social scientists, ethicists, healthcare providers, patients, families, people with disability, policymakers, regulators, funders, faith leaders, public interest advocates, industry representatives, and members of the general public. It's quite a long list. So whatever you may think about these statements and about my position in technology and society, I think it's clearly a departure from what is now known as ASILOMAR, the ASILOMAR conference. As I told earlier, in the early 1970s, the new technique for modifying DNA emerged, and prominent scientists called for a voluntary worldwide moratorium on recombinant DNA experiments, out of concern that they might unwittingly create new pathogens. And this was followed by an international consortium of biologists in which they hoped to establish guidelines for recombinant DNA technology, but also to bypass public regulatory intervention. So in 1975, scientists came together at the ASILOMAR Conference Center in California. I think there are worse places to have a conference. And in this conference, the nature and magnitude of the risk of recombinant DNA technology was assessed. And ASILOMAR became the Woodstock of bioscience. It was considered an expression of scientific responsibility. But it has also been criticized. As political scientist Ben Hurlburt has put it, the scientific community assumed the authority to define science responsibilities in the present and to declare what promises can be made, what risks warrant worry, and what technological futures are possible, desirable, and good. So ASILOMAR, they framed the questions very narrowly in risk assessment, which was used to justify the recommendation that came out of the meeting and the lack of public participation in formulating them. Actually, in ASILOMAR, some elitists, predominantly male white scientists, were making public policy in private. And they framed it in terms of technical risk assessments, while scholars, such as Sabine Rooser, for example, have shown that risk assessment is inherently value-laden. So what we need for germline genome editing are new, modern, and much more inclusive 21st century ASILOMARs. So what are those new ASILOMARs, and what should be the role of government and politics in the governance of germline genome editing? And here we actually arrive at a paradox in the more classic liberal schools of ethical theories. Liberal ethics, of which I'm a part as well, They contend that in a liberal, pluralistic society, people have fundamental different views on the good life. Liberals have historically argued that decisions about the good life should be in hands of individuals. We call this thin morality. But technologies such as CRISPR-Cas will have many hard and soft societal impacts, which means both quantifiable impacts, but also impacts on our values, our perceptions, our behavior. To requote Sheila Yesenov, our inventions change the world, and the reinvented world changes us. So germline genome editing technology cannot be left to individuals, cannot be left to private life, to individual groups of scientists. And this means that we have to be aware that governance decisions about CRISPR-Cas are not technical decisions, but they are decisions about the good life. And if we think that we need democratic governance of science and technology, then politics has to articulate and voice views about the good life. This is unavoidable. As I explained, liberal governments and also liberal ethicists cannot persevere in being neutral towards the good life. As I said before, technology and humans are so interrelated that we and our government should not ask the dichotomous question whether you are for or against gene editing, but rather, what values do we deem important? What kind of society do we want? And how does gene editing fit into this society? In the end, technological questions about biotechnology are deeply political and moral. And many of the concerns of, for example, the bioconservatives to germline modification do not target the technology as such, but they target what they consider the underlying societal values, such as the strive for perfection and inequality. So I think these values should be the focus of debate, in which philosophers, there is a role for philosophers, they can play an important role because they are trained to examine, articulate, and evaluate moral intuitions and values. But in the end, the governance should take place on a societal level. And this is difficult, not only because of this paradox in liberal ethics, but also due to the history of eugenics with which we started. Since then, it has been quite a taboo to discuss the application of genetics from a governance and a societal perspective for decades. Genetics was only framed in a very narrow clinical model, in the individual encounter between the doctor and the patient. Germline modification urges us to take into account the wider effects in deciding how to develop and govern genome editing. And also the historical lessons learned from eugenics should, of course, not be forgotten, but we also should be sensitive to the many differences between genome editing and 20th century eugenics. Any governance model should not only pay attention to safety issues, ethics oversight, but should particularly incorporate the implications of germline modification for values such as reproductive autonomy, distributive justice, equity, access to healthcare, and the role of people with disabilities. So I think we have to find ways to deal in a workable, reasonable, maybe even rational way with a plurality of convictions, worldviews, and emotions regarding germline genome editing. And there are no standard operating procedures for starting a public bioethical debate followed by democratic decision making. But I think that the process that led to the permission of mitochondrial replacement technologies in the UK seems like a learning practice, maybe even a best practice. So I would like to say some final words about the international dimension of the ethics and governance of CRISPR-Cas. Some people express deterministic views, such as the narrative that it will happen in China or Korea anyway. And the examples of Mexico and Ukraine are examples that this is actually true, up to a certain extent. Biotechnologies will be used in irresponsible, premature ways, but we should not tell ourselves that we don't have any control. I think then we trap in the deterministic fallacy, which is not only untrue, but even dangerous. We all know there is no international body that has the authority to establish and enforce international guidelines for germline genome editing. And in view of the variety of legislative and regulatory jurisdiction throughout the world, even within nations, legal harmonization for CRISPR-Cas, but also for mitochondrial replacement technology, is unlikely and I think also undesirable. because how biotechnology and germline modification will be framed is inevitably shaped by culture, political culture, and also context. Countries and cultures have different collectively held visions, ideas, and also institutions to deal with new technology, different ways of framing the ethical questions, dealing with the controversies, and coming to closures. And this is sometimes called social-technical imaginaries for the sociologist in the room. But what is both necessary and I think also possible is to the development of ethical principles to at least guide the research. Historically, some powerful examples exist where the international community has successfully developed international guidelines for the ethical conduct in research, such as, for example, the World Medical Association Declaration of Helsinki, which you can see over here. And these guidelines are clearly moral guidelines, meaning that they entail shared moral principles that countries can voluntarily use to help frame their local regulations. And their concomitant adoption by funding agencies, research institutes, and editorial policies, as has been done over the years, will contribute to the achievement of some form of improved global bioethics governance. I think, again, that it's a mistaken and even dangerous view to perceive science and biotechnology as autonomous forces that cannot be governed. So, I hope I have shown to you that genome editing, and specifically germline modification, has such an impact on a broad array of human life that it in the end will also edit society. It will edit food, reproduction, medicine, but it will also edit our values. But I think this is okay, as I see technology and humans as closely related and also as intertwined. We were able already a very long time ago to build artifacts and instruments and to govern new developments to fit our societal values. As, for example, Yuval Harari has shown in his two, I think, quite brilliant books. So responsible innovation implies that ethics and democratic decision-making should be an intrinsic part of this field. Ethics and philosophy are needed to explore and scrutinize intuitions, to clarify the problems at stake, for example, to clarify all those 169 arguments, and to guide which consideration should be taken into account. And these can provide the input for a public discussion and for a political discussion. We cannot design blueprints for new challenges posed by scientific and technological progress, but what we can do is continuously explore what values we want CRISPR-Cas to promote and enhance, and which negative effects should be minimized as much as possible. And remember that ethics, in the end, only results in what John Rawls called provisional fixed points. It's just temporal and context-specific. And it's much easier to retrospectively evaluate biotechnology with the wisdom of hindsight than to predict the effects and implications of new biotechnology. So this gives us epistemic, political, and also moral reasons to use as many perspectives as possible and to include as many voices as possible. Epistemic reasons, because we intrinsically make decisions based on very uncertain and incomplete information. Political reasons, because there is inherent pluralism. And an important way to approach pluralism is a serious dialogue between people. As Hannah Arendt says, the world is not inhabited by mankind, but by men, so by all individual people. And lastly, there are moral reasons, because in the end, genome editing will edit society. Thank you very much for your attention. Are there any questions? Kees.
I really appreciated your speech. I thought you gave a wonderful and balanced overview of the fields and the research, and you plead for sort of the very later discussion in a pluralistic society. But what I missed a little bit, that's not a criticism, but I missed it basically, is your personal perspective. What is your personal opinion on how we should apply or not apply this kind of thing? What kind of guidelines inform your personal opinion?
Yeah. Well, I think with my fourth position, in which I say science and technology and humans are very intertwined, so don't ask, are you in favor or against, but think about reasonable ways forward. I think I already made a position, which is developing ethical conditions for using the technique. So in the end, I'm in favor of developing germline genome editing and even discussing with each other whether we need to change our legislation. Yeah. Well, I think... Yes, for me, that's the values which are the same as the values of medicine in general, which is preventing disease, avoiding unnecessary suffering, helping people to not die prematurely. That are, for me, important values. Yeah. Yes. Well, thank you for this question. To repeat it for you, the question is about that I didn't talk about commercialization or just mentioned it as a result from the literature review. I think this is a huge problem, but it's not confined to CRISPR-Cas. And actually, it's quite sad that at the moment, the two universities who at the same time developed CRISPR-Cas are now in a big patent fight with each other. So on the one hand, MIT versus the University of where Jennifer Doudna is working. Some people even say that she didn't get the Nobel Prize because the Nobel Prize Committee doesn't like people fighting on this stuff. So I completely agree that it's more of a problem in the agricultural applications than in the germline applications, because companies cannot make enough money with these kind of applications, but maybe that will be the case as the IVF industry. So I think this is a much broader problem about how we have our pattern system. I think in the end, if people want to go to a low governance country where they can do whatever they want, then they will do it. So I think we should not focus our energy on those small examples, but just focus our energy on the big group of countries and researcher who is willing to formulate ethics principles. And that's what I tried to say about China, that even China, I know China, the Chinese Academy of Sciences is now organizing a follow-up of the Washington DC conference next year in Beijing, and they try to take the lead in the ethical discussion. So I think that should be the focus, like the World Medical Association Declaration of Helsinki, which is now less influential than 10 years ago, but still it's, I think, a powerful example. Yeah, but when some people just do whatever they want, it's still not a reason for us to think, okay, well, let them do. I'm an optimist. Yeah.
How optimistic are you about the perspective of institutional innovation that will allow us to accommodate these discussions or public discussions about the good life?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think it's a maybe some other countries like the UK have more experience. And I think we, as we talked before, we didn't learn to have this political or public discourse about the good life. And I think also liberal politicians will say, that's not my domain. So I think we have to learn this. And also departments of governance, political sciences, even ethicists, can help trying to have this kind of discourses. Yeah, but we don't have it yet, I think.
Thank you very much. May I invite Quadrivium again?
Good evening, everyone. I was asked to use the gender-neutral term everyone instead of ladies and gentlemen, so I hope that you recognize that. First, I would like to say thanks to Annelien for her splendid lecture And as I mentioned to her just a minute ago, I still think technology as such is neutral, but not necessarily the development of technology is neutral. But that's maybe a debate for at the drinks. At this point of the evening, I'd like to bid a special welcome to the researchers here who submitted a proposal for the Meikle Prize, and to their friends and family who came along for this evening. Each year, every year, the Meikle Prize is awarded to the most responsible innovation at the Delft University of Technology. And what do we mean by that? Responsible innovation means that we try to bring our research and innovation in line with the needs and values of society. Do not harm, or do no harm, is an important principle of the Hippocratic Oath that doctors take. And I think it's an important principle when developing technology as well. That is why, as a university, we believe it's essential that our researchers and students think about ethical questions early on, that they think about the impact their work may have on the environment and on society, and that they include such considerations in their research and innovation. As many of them take this to heart, and only yesterday, Jet Gispen from the Faculty of Design Engineering became our best graduate of the Delft University of Technology. Jet created a toolkit for incorporating ethics into the design process. We are not the only ones to think along those lines. Responsible innovation is now a central concern in the European Innovation Policy. It's an important criterion in programs like Horizon 2020, and in 2008, the Dutch research organization NWO launched a specific program on responsible innovation. And we learned from Annelien that also professors of philosophy count. Our professor of philosophy, Jeroen van der Hoven, was very influential in these two programs. This year, we had no less than 22 applications for the Meikle Prize. An impressive number, and all of them of an impressive quality. And across the board, they were as varied as the subjects we teach and we research on. Projects ranging from a smart way to diagnose malaria, to high-performance materials developed from wastewater, from e-sensors to detect fake pharmaceuticals, to serious games to engage citizens in societal challenges. So you can imagine that the jury had a hard time making a choice. And it's in the last category, serious games, that we find the winner. So I will not longer hold you in suspense and reveal that the winner is the serious game, Parsifal Playing Fields. Please wait a moment. There's a few more words I would say, like to say before I invite you up here. So before I will ask you to come up here, let me tell you something about this wonderful project. Parsifal Playing Fields is actually a combination of a serious game and an artistic performance based on Wagner's Parsifal. Why a serious game? Serious games have proven to be an effective way to bring about awareness, to acquire skills, to change behavior, and to influence social patterns. So it is in many ways more effective than professional training or policy workshops or brainstorms if you want to tackle complex problems. As it happens, we face some pretty complex problems as society, as we heard tonight, but also topics like climate change or social exclusion belong to them. And if we want to solve them, we have to involve a whole lot of different stakeholders, as we heard tonight. And if we do that in a theater game like Parsifal, there is an added benefit. In a theater game, people undergo so-called embodied experiences. That means, simply put, that you experience something not just in your mind or in your head, but also with your body and with your emotions. So the Parsifal game players make players think about how they can make their city more sustainable and what their own role can be in that. During the game, they learn how difficult it is to hold on to values like compassion and collaboration, and they are confronted with their own selfishness. As a result, they often reconsider their values and decide to improve their behavior. And then, when they are back at their place of work, they hopefully act on what they have experienced during the game. The jury was particularly impressed by the way this innovation can be used to engage citizens in challenges facing our society. It would also be interesting to use it in teaching at the Delft University of Technology, and that is likely to happen soon. Parsifal D-Game is now being customized to be played in cities, at companies, and at schools all over the world. So I would now like to ask the winners to come forward so I can hand them the prize. There's two more jobs I have to do, and one includes a dilemma, and the other one is very simple, invite you for the drinks afterwards. The dilemma is the fact that we have 40 of these books, and these books are called Op Herhaling. It's a reprint of an almost 60-year-old book of the memory of all those died, all those students that died in the war. I can tell a lot of things about it. At the back you can find a picture of Frans van Hasselt. And I decided that I would invite the older people to take the book along, because I'm sure there will be a new version later on, so the younger people in some years from now can take the book then. So it's up to you to decide whether you're young or whether you're somewhat older. There is 40 books for the somewhat older generation. And now I would like to invite you for the drinks.